right, so firstly, I just wanted to ask you, how did the name Thoughtbreaker came about? What was the inspiration with that?
It's a good question. The inspiration kind of came from, I guess, just like the Chicago drill scene, as generic as that may sound. It started as Dead as Fuck in the early rounds of like printing and shit. And then I made that first initial logo, and then it just kind of stuck. So it was mostly like a blip in a thought process. Ha. And I just kind of put it together, and then I realized like, yo, that should just be it. That should fucking be it. So that's kind of how it started. It was kind of like an aha moment that was a gradual process.
Yeah.
But then once it kind of hit, it was like, it just kind of kept hitting, and I was like, dude, this is for sure going to be what I want to roll with.
So yeah, that's dope.
Shout out all the musical acts that inspired that. You know, it's a Chicago word. So it just kind of, all the things kind of tied together by themselves.
So with the logo, was there really anything that kind of gave you inspiration for that logo?
You know, it was just kind of like, I saw everyone wearing, like, I don't even want to say the company name, but, you know, like, the skater tees and shit of Thrasher. So I was like, maybe I could just fuck around and do something like that. And it just kind of worked out. And I used to skate back in the day, so I was like, you know what, I'm just going to run with it. We faced some backlash from it here and there, but overall, I think it was more of a positive response. And even if we still run that logo years from now, we've kind of steered away from it, but I'm sure there's more cultural meaning behind that logo than there is, like, you know, Forever 21 ripping off the logo, or like,
yeah,
I'm ripping off the Thrasher logo. Like, all that is corporate bullshit, and that's something I kind of want to steer away from, you know?
Yeah, I respect that. What is the relationship between you and Do Not Resuscitate?
Ooh, okay. We keep it kind of cool. I don't have any negative ill will towards Hesh and his brand. I think some of the designs have been kind of cool. I like the police stuff that they do, the anti-police stuff that they do. It's G to me, you know. That's G to me. Any hustle is a good hustle. You know, I admire the hustle and the perseverance, you know?
Definitely. Would you say that, because, you know, like in the rap scene, there's a huge amount of, like, competitiveness. And would you say it's the same with the underground clothing shit? Is there a lot of competition?
Dude, honestly, that is a dope-ass question. I you know, it's like, I want to characterize it as competition, because I'm a very competitive spirit at heart, even though I didn't do, you know, like, I didn't really go into any sports teams, you know, I played a lot of sports in the early days, but I have a very competitive spirit. I actually had more competitive spirit when I was starting Thoughtbreaker, and maybe we can get into that later, but yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of that, but honestly, it was never like, yo, I gotta up, you know, all, you know what, it was like self-competition. Like, I just wanted to up myself and my grade and my, like, with the help of my friends too, and just keep making cooler shit. It's never about, like, you know, competition with anyone else. You know, I'm kind of like a kind spirited person. So,
yeah,
but it's always that there is always that element, you know, there's always that edge of like, you know, I see what you're doing, and I definitely want to do something, you know, I want to definitely up the level and do something that, you know, people haven't thought of before. So, sure, you know, I'm competitive as fuck, and I'm going to be, if someone's going to throw the ball at me, I definitely want to, you know, swing it as hard as I can.
Hell yeah. You know, that reminds me, I started, because I've owned multiple labels and multiple pages, and Dejected kind of came to me as its own separate brand, separate idea. But I remember when I started it, do you remember Dead Boy Management?
I do. Ooh, early days. Someone I like was like, yo, this guy like, you know, does his clothes and shit. That was someone I was like, definitely, like, I want to definitely get to that level, you know, ASAP type shit.
And you know what? Jesse Taylor gave me such a hard time trying to break into that kind of thing. And it's so weird that even with labels, that there's that sense of competition. And it really interests me, because I think really any aspect of art, there's always this kind of competition. But I think the fine line is where it's good-hearted competition, and then there's a type of competition where you're trying to squash your opponent.
Exactly. Hey, you hit the nail right on the head, man. Yeah, I definitely agree with that. And I've tried to be on like a clean slate with it. There's been times where, you know, people have done shady shit to me, and then, you know, we will, you know, go back and forth about it. But I always feel like, put it this way, where I draw the line is like leaving negative reviews on people's fucking pages. After that, bro, I'm like, you're a fucking pussy. Fuck you. And I don't fuck with that, you know, type of shit. That's where I'm like, dumb as hell. Come on. But yeah, no, I remember Dead Boy Management. And there's a few other homies, like local homies too, that kind of, I want to say they made it hard for me. Cause it kind of just came out of nowhere really quick.
Yeah. So,
but I can imagine if I was like on a different playing field, if I was what I was doing with Thoughtbreaker, like on a record label, so to say, I'm sure, you know, it would have been maybe a different climate. You know, I'm sure Jesse would maybe looked at me differently. Who knows? You know, but again, he had a lot of controversy surrounding him, and I don't know, you know, where he's at now with things, but I hope, you know, things are peaceful and things are looking good.
I'm going to go ahead and go in. I interviewed an artist last night. He goes by the name Neptune, and me and him were a part of a tour where the whole infamous thing happened where Keep My Secrets kind of, you know, beat the shit out of him, and that whole thing happened. And I have to tell you, Jesse Taylor in person is a totally different person than he acts online, and it's really interesting. And I think it finally hit his head, because now he completely kind of reverted away from music, and he started an organic vegan farm.
Wow. Yeah, I remember he would post. That's one thing about Jesse I really respect, was like, I don't want to use the umbrella term woke, but some of those views I definitely align with, you know, like,
yeah,
vegan has like potential to change the world, you know, and changes the lives for a lot of people. But that's the thing, I haven't heard about that. He's, I don't know if I'm just not following him on the right pages, or if we're just not following each other, but mad respect. Like, he's a hustler with it. But yeah, I do recall that tour, and that was kind of like, it was like kind of fucked up. You know, honestly, everyone had some sort of fault in it, you know,
but definitely. It just kind of
his shoulders, because it was his management or something like that. You know, I don't mean to put words out there, just from the gist of what I know.
Oh, you're definitely right.
And what do you think of his vegan farm? What do you think about it?
You know, I've checked out a few videos, and I have to admit, he's doing very successful. He's going to farmer markets, and it seems like he's selling his product very well, and he knows to seem the science behind it, and I really respect him for that. And, you know, I think he did make some mistakes on that tour, but I'm glad to see that he is moving forward.
Yeah, no more beef, okay?
No more beef. Definitely.
I hate to be corny sometimes. I just had to.
So, I do a kind of Howard Stern-style interview where I like to bring up things you might not necessarily think about or might not like to think about, but I think it makes an interesting interview. So I wanted to talk to you. There is a girl by the name of Kylie Dawn.
Yes.
And she seems to put things out there, and I just wanted to know your side of the story of that situation.
Yeah, let's do it. I actually popped my head like a couple of days ago, just out of the blue, because someone wanted the mushroom tee that she designed, which was an awesome t-shirt design. Love her designs, always did. She was Indy's ex, and there was and one of my other friends, and so there was like complications with like networking and business working. But we had already like this. We had already been like, "Yo, I fuck with you," you know, this and that. Let's work together. And then I found all that. And, you know, I was all like, dude, like, I don't know, you know, like, we already have the shirt done. People love it. Like, let's just run it. But do you have any specifics? Or can I just, like, kind of go in on, like, kind of the whole spiel?
What I heard is that, basically, to put it short, is that somehow that you fucked her over in some sense.
Cool. Okay. Well, if that's the sentiment, then it seems like nothing was really learned. I had an associate, like my friend, my boy, Jared, and he made this little call out post because coming back to the DNR thing, this is kind of where I didn't really know what to do with DNR. Kind of was like, oh, you know, we kind of beefed a little bit there, so it's like a little bit weird, but I assume we still kind of have respect, you know, we have respect for each other,
right?
But her Junji Ito fucking t-shirt that her boyfriend at the time kind of copy and pasted, edited, you know, ever so slight, edited, you know, to be formatted on a t-shirt, some nice fonts, clean design, cool. Friend Jared was like, yo, I saw it, I might have even liked it or something, who knows. Jared saw it. He said something about it, nondescript. And then what ensued was like a 500 comment thread of the most funniest back and forth bashings of online rhetoric I've probably ever read. It was extremely funny, like very funny. Some of it got very, very out of hand and way off, like crossing the line, which I will agree with. Some of his homies are kind of fucked up, and I actually didn't really fuck with that. Especially when they mentioned her like mental illness as a joke and shit like that.
Yeah, right.
That I vibe with ever. That, you know, that wasn't cool. But, you know, Lil Baphomet, Jesus Christ, I still have the fucking memes. I still have the meme, and I ever so often I find it when I'm scrolling through my phone for like pictures and shit, where he's holding like the two fucking AKs, whatever fucking guns he has.
Yeah.
And someone was like, on my way to steal your art, bro. Oh my God. That's the only gripe I have about the Kylie situation. The only gripe I have with it was like, yo, you guys technically stole art from another artist, which I don't really see Junji Ito, or so probably is now, but I don't really see Junji Ito as like a streetwear fashion designer. She straight up stole that art from a manga. It was kind of perfect for a t-shirt, sure, but it was still like stolen nonetheless, and it was still like kind of... I saw it was like an instant back and forth. Kylie got aggressive, like right off the bat. Why don't you at me? Tell me how you feel. Jared is an individual with literally no walls that barred him. So he was just like, all right, I'm going to tell you how I feel. LOL. So it just went back and forth. And then her boyfriend got involved. And it went straight down the fucking toilet for him as well. Like both of these individuals just kind of tarnished and ruined their career over a fucking Junji Ito shirt, which, like, if I was caught in that situation, let me tell you, if I was caught in that situation, I would have been like, hey, I fucked up, I'm sorry, I'm gonna take it down, we're gonna reformat it, you know, it's all cool, I'm sorry, dudes, you know, I fucked up, haha, you know, we're human.
Exactly, cool. I think, but if you can admit to a mistake.
Exactly, and that's the part I didn't vibe with. That's the only reason why I didn't stop it there so short, like, so soon. So I was like, you guys fucked up. Like, I'm hearing no discussion about, like, you know, like, I'm sorry, not even an apology or anything like that. Like, I don't even know what to call it, but it just kept getting, they kept going back and forth. I'm pretty sure Baphomet threatened to shoot Jared's dog, which is fucked up, but it, like, really pushed these two guys, like, to their limit. And it was, and then once they started leaving negative reviews, that's the first time, like, up until that point, Fabric had, like, full 5 stars. It was fun and dandy, and then after that, I was like, "Wow, fuck, we're down like 4.5 or some shit now." But after that, I told Jared, "Hey, let's just stop it," because it went on for like 2 or 3 days, bro. Like the next day, people were still commenting, and I told Jared, "I was like, hey, bro, I fuck with you, man, but let's just stop it because you know they're leaving negative reviews. Like we done beat the horse, you know, to a pulp. Let's just dip. And yeah. he did. I really, which I was like respectful of, you know? So honestly, it was just, it was fun. It was shitty. I'm a very remorseful person. Like when I do stuff, when like stuff like this happens, like there's always like an internal like battle of like calling peace or just continue the, just the atrocity that is the internet, that is right. Facebook.
Yeah, definitely.
That's just kind of how Facebook is, you know, like, and if you can't accept that aspect about Facebook, it's not going to go well for you. It just isn't. So, but at the end of the day, I wanted to call peace and, you know, like, you know, I think a couple of weeks or months passed by. I think maybe unless it's in my imagination, I'm pretty sure we like DM'd each other and said some sort of apology or something like that. Baphomet did, surprisingly. It was like half a year later, you know, after they broke up, he's like, yo, it's fucked up. I'm sorry about that. You know, I still fuck with you. I don't know if I accepted, like, I don't know. I accepted it, but I don't know if we like, I haven't talked to him since. But yeah, that was like in the early days of Thoughtbreaker, like a little beef history. I don't even want to call it that. It's so gay. Yeah. But just like the early days of that, you know, and being a brand owner, I'm like, what do I do? Do I just, there's no manual for this shit, you know? Like, right. Literally, no manual for, you know, running pages, for handling, you know, disputes. You just got to go with your heart and your gut feeling.
Exactly. I got two heavy topics to talk about here, but let me reposition because I am sitting uncomfortable as fuck.
Does Kylie do any art for you or anything like that? Or does she still do art?
She does still promote art, but I have never worked with her in that sense. But if I'm being 100%, we had a romanticism, and that is where I heard about all this stuff.
Yeah, you know, she's like, shout out to her. Like, she's, you know, she may be hot-headed and self-righteous, maybe a little prideful, but that's just people's characteristics, you know, for better or worse. I respect, she's talented, you know, like I'm telling you, that mushroom shirt, a lot of people definitely wanted it, and I'm kind of like on the fence of, you know, if I can even bring that back, you know, type thing.
Yeah, definitely.
But, yeah.
So the next two topics, and I want you to know 100%, I don't have any biased opinions. I'm not coming at you sideways. These are just general inquiries.
I love it. Totally. You're cool.
So firstly, I wanted to talk about, do you know Ritual Magic Fabric?
I do. Ritual Magic Fabrics makes my head spin and makes me feel things. But what, continue your question.
The owner, me and him had a collab. We did a clothing line collab and we had a few phone calls. And he was telling me that Thoughtbreaker went completely broke and that you print your clothing very low quality and that you were kind of making up, I guess, schemes of things being stolen so that you could earn some extra cash.
Whoa, this came completely left field. First off, I don't even know. I mean, now I'm just drawing lines and connections and networks of how he would have even, I've never disclosed any of this information to him. It's honestly kind of like personal stuff, but some of it, but yeah, no, that break-in was fucked up, like really fucked up. That was not staged, and someone else in the fucking scene we're working with too, like, was kind of implying that as well, saying that we didn't want to pay a DJ to perform under this and that, and we were just using that excuse. It's not plausible. You can talk to any of the people that have visited the warehouse, our ex-warehouse, that's a whole other topic, afterwards, and tell you, yeah, that fucking office space was literally empty for the remainder of the fucking time we were there. And I'm gracious to God that I left my laptop with all the Thoughtbreaker stuff at home. And my equipment was just too... that. Maybe that's where he got that from, because my equipment wasn't stolen. But then again, my equipment's like heavy and bulky, and I'm pretty sure these fucking nutwits of fucking human beings who are just like, nah, we're just gonna take it. And what's fucked up too? They fucking, the people that stole the shit, first off, they stole a lot of shit. They stole two fucking $600 tablets. They stole like $1,200 computers, Tyler's camera, you know, and this was all stuff that was purchased by a dude, you know, he was, that was investing in Thoughtbreaker.
Right.
So, the day that we went broke is like fucking rude. Like, fuck that. What happened was they were broke. We threw this event, this car event, we had word of there were maybe shady people involved. You know, I was on the fence of being like, hey, let's be cautious. Some people were like, let's just, you know, run it. You know, we'll be fine with whatever happens. I'm a precautious dude. I have anxiety, so I see the inevitable outcomes in so many fucking situations.
Yeah, me too.
Nonetheless, I said, you know, fuck it. Let's run it nonetheless. It was a dope night. There was a fucking car with a bunch of anime, with anime wrapped all around completely. Some VIP shit. So fire. Dope. Next day, I go in first thing in the morning to go print some shit, get some shit, you know, readied out and stuff. I go in the office space where we have, like, all those things where we do our design and creative collective stuff. I'm like, this place is fucking trash. Like, how drunk did they get? Because I left kind of early. People stayed till like 2 or 3 a.m. And we think the people that did this waited for us to leave. And then they smashed the front windows, the front door window things. And, yeah, I walk in. I'm like, this place is fucking trash. I just kind of like just a 30-second little blip. And then I'm like, and then I look at the window and it's fucking broken. Big ass hole, cracked, you know, glass everywhere. And then I look back to the mess. I'm like, everything is fucking gone. So I call Tyler in like a sweat, be like, hey, dude, what do I do? Call the cops, you know, for sure. And it's funny story. The cops had visited us one other time. I forgot for whatever reason. And they checked out the fucking website. I forgot who was like, yeah, look, here's the website, you know, not like we have like a bunch of ACAB merch on there, you know?
Right.
So they already knew about us. They're like, oh, you're the Thoughtbreaker people. Or like one of them, I think, had a hint. I don't remember. I don't fucking remember. But one of the cops was like, just kind of like brushing it off as if it was like, just whatever, you know, huh, that sucks type shit. The other cop was, you know, shout out her. She was actually, we had like a little tracker on one of the, tracker on one of the towers that Tyler bought, one of his computers, and it showed, it like binged in like the area. She was nice enough to go actually check it out. But we didn't get any leads. We didn't get any detectives. We really had nothing to go off of. And we were really hoping someone from the car scene would help us out on it, but they didn't. So that's like the background story that just to make that quick and concise, going back to what you said. So it was a couple things. So there's that. That was not a fucking scam or a scheme. That's really fucking shady. I'm really against like quick, get rich quick schemes.
Right.
Maybe I should be because like honestly, but that's just not my heart, man. In fact, I do the opposite. I put in more work than I have to sometimes. Some of these designs that you see, you know, they look simple and easy as fuck, but I'm in there sometimes like perfecting each fucking line, making sure each vector point is lining up correctly type shit.
Yeah, yeah.
It's hectic work. I put in a lot of sweat in the shit.
Yeah, you know, I have to say, that shirt, I wear that shit a lot, and I really do think it's quality. I really think, you know, the design is great.
Which shirt was it again? Just for the peeps.
I don't remember what it was called, but it's a anime nun.
Was it the nun with the tits and the pussy out?
Yes.
Nice, dude. That shirt has my top three designs. The back of it is gorgeous.
I fucking love that. Yes.
Dude, I love you for that. So
I actually posted that shit all over my Instagram.
Right here, bro. Quality's on point. There's a couple to drill that in. There's a couple different outlets. Like that's you know, that's one of my facets, like the anime stuff, the full printed stuff. The other stuff I use is you know, I kinda don't wanna go into that. That's kinda like my spiel.
Oh, you know, no worries, man.
I don't know where he's getting, I don't know where he's coming off, because he's never, as far as I've known, I've never sent him any Thoughtbreaker. He's never bought any Thoughtbreaker. So I'm just kind of confused, you know?
Right, so if you could just quickly address his statement of your clothing being low quality, how would you respond to that?
It's not.
we can keep it simple and straight.
It's not low quality. It's you know, it's just as good as that stuff that you buy at stores, man. And if you're doubtful, like, get some yourself, you know, and try it out. I'm pretty adamant if something goes wrong, which things do, you know, we're human beings.
Definitely.
Then, you know, we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. I'm a human being. I don't like getting stuff and then being like, oh, you know, I thought it was going to be like this. You know, there's been times where, you know, maybe a customer got a wrong product. And I've sent him another one or did some kind of credit situation. At the end of the day, it's a business, and my top priority is making people happy. So, you know, you can't put quality on that. You know, that's as good as it can get. You know, like, I want to make people, you know, feel good about what they're wearing.
There, you know, and there's always human error, but I have to admit that, I mean, there are some ride or die Thoughtbreaker fans. I have seen multiple times people wear that shit until there's nothing left of it.
Dude, yeah, there's someone
where totally, yeah. So I wanted to ask you, in the very beginning, how did you go about getting your brand out there?
Ooh, I love this question. Bro, I love these questions, man. This interview did not go how I was expecting. Good shit.
You know, I've gained a little bit of notoriety.
Yeah, these are fire. So here, what was it again? How did I get it to start? Or say one more time, you worded it really well.
In the beginning, how did you go about getting your brand out there?
Dude, in the beginning, I just had to cut off all my fucking local homies, all the locals I had projects with, cut them all fucking off because none of them were serious, and it was bringing me down, like, confidence wise. There's always been a stubborn part of me where I'm like, I'm gonna do it. My parents hate it. But I'm gonna do it. My friends aren't putting their side in. Fuck it, I'm gonna still do it. So I think that was like the part one of it. Thoughtbreaker started as like an antithesis almost to like everything that was going on. Like, it was just something that I wanted to believe in and put my blood, sweat, and tears in. So the first thing was just like, I just had to stop talking to these people. You know, I didn't smoke with them no more. I didn't interact with them no more. I was lost on Instagram, trying to get up on Instagram. I didn't even use Facebook back in the day that much. I was kind of scared too, because it was like a lot of like my close friends, and I was like, nah, you know, like, I want to stay away from that.
Yeah, break out from your city.
So in the early days, you know, I was just on Instagram. And dude, if anyone remembers me back, like when I had like just some random username, I forgot what it was. Like before, it was just like kind of just little tidbits of stuff. Nothing like with like meat, if that makes sense, nothing like concise yet.
Right,
but
right.
On Instagram fucking being like, oh man, I want like 1,000 followers, you know, I want to make a business, you know, what's this passive income shit, you know, Ty Lopez every fucking ad on my YouTube, you know, like
yeah.
It was like a motivation, but looking back on it now, it wasn't the right motivation, but I'm glad I went through that, because I think in a lot of ways, you know, some people they want their art to prosper and to sustain. Very difficult. Even to this day, it's fucking...
It is hard.
It's hard as fuck, dude. Sometimes, man, I'm, like, so tired. But, you know, we find the strength and we keep going. But in the early days, yeah, I was at, like, 600 followers. I'm like, I gotta get to 1,000. You know, I just had, like, the wrong mentality, I guess, going in. But it was a mentality nonetheless. So that was the early day. I actually, funny enough, the funny story is, So that was like the early days. Once it started like gaining traction, like before that, I was actually like kind of like, I'm pretty sure I gave up a couple times. I think we all like have those bouts where we're like, nah, it's not worth it no more.
Yeah. I've been there a lot of times.
Traveled the road too long, man. There's nothing, you know? And I was kind of at that point. And then I met this guy, Indy LaFlame.
Oh, I love Indy, man.
I know. He's a fucking dude, man. I met him, I think before that, I just started adding a bunch of SoundCloud-looking peeps on Facebook. Yeah, and yeah. Honest, the best decision I ever made. That's a weird thing to say. That's a very weird thing to say, but I guess it worked out.
You know, I did the same thing starting out, and it did work.
Yeah. And that around that time, that's when, like, X was really hot, Peak was really hot, you know, it was like the flower was just blooming, you know, it was finally out of, like, the soil was blooming, so it was a really popping scene. And yeah, I sent him a hoodie for some beats.
Nice.
Loki, I don't think I actually got the beats, but it's okay. You know, it's all good. And then after that, oh no, hold up, rewind. Do you know Lucas Versace? I think you do, right?
Yes, I do, yeah.
Lucas Versace. Yeah, no, I think I sent those two items to them, like, at the same conjuncture.
Okay, yeah.
I sent India hoodie just because he was in America, and I had that hoodie from this drop. Actually, that was, like, the first printed Lunar Girl designs. So that was, like, a first batch of samples that I got.
Oh, you know what was really cool, man? I did a show, I want to say it was in Washington, and somebody after the show actually gave me one of those Luna Girl shirts.
No fucking way.
Yeah, man.
What?
I think I still have it put away in, I got so many crates, but somebody gave that to me.
That's insane. I can't even think of anyone off the top of my head that's in Washington. So, that's magical. That's like, that probably, like, crossed, like, a wormhole or some shit. I fucking swear to God.
For real, at the time, I didn't even know what it was. And then later on, I was like, wow, that was pretty fucking cool.
That's dope. That's really dope. I love that happened. Lunar Girl was definitely something that needed to happen, you know. It was a design in months of making and shit like that. Yeah, that's basically kind of how it started, you know.
Yeah,
I gave it to my peeps. We all got together within a week, and then we just kind of all coincided.
And I wanted to ask, do you think, like, when you sponsor somebody or, you know, kind of hook somebody up, is it generally a good way to bring business back to you?
Oh, dude, that's like one of those, like, you flip the coin kind of questions. It can go either way. Ironically, all the people, like Manny Del Torre, aka Ethereal Lotus, you know.
Oh, Manny's dope, man.
I love Manny. Shout out Manny.
I got an episode with him coming up too.
Yeah, dude, that's awesome. Yeah, no, stuff like that, when it's pure of heart and the homies are homies and, you know, it's a good person, it goes genuinely very well. There, but the sucky part is, this is why I don't do a lot of sponsorships, and I'm kind of like, I don't know what to do with it, really. It's because all the people that I sponsored after, you know, Worm, Ethereal Lotus, Indie, I forgot the other peeps, Band Goblin, too.
You know, yeah.
After the initial people that were sponsored, like, it was all kind of flukes and flakes and shitty people, like the Audrey situation, for example. Like, that was like the,
man.
It was like one of the best yet simultaneously worst fucking collabs ever.
That was actually my next question.
Segway.
Oh,
yeah, but generally it goes, now it's going really good. I think I think it's going really good lately. I got a couple collabs coming up actually this month.
Nice. Funny.
So to anyone listening to this, you know, cool stuff coming up.
And shameless plug really quick, all of these in the next coming weeks will all be available on Spotify, so motherfuckers, go listen to that shit.
Yeah, I'm gonna put everybody on.
Hell yeah. And that actually is my next question. Unfortunately, I have to say that I did have the pleasure of knowing Audrey well for a while, and... His side of it was that you couldn't keep up with supply and demand and that he was never paid. Like, what is your side to that?
Oh, I hate I hate internet people like this so much. This guy more than 50-50, bro. I paid this guy, like, I asked my girlfriend at the time, I'm like, should I pay him this much just to, like, avoid, just to, this is me. this guy, I thought he was like a friend. I knew he had, like, you know, mental health problems. I knew he was a little cuckoo.
Right.
But, you know, like, I want to help. I'm a helpful person.
Yeah, so I can see that.
Fucking send him money. That's, and I fucking have screenshots. I don't even know where they're at now, but I'll look back on the PayPal history. I sent him over 50% of what he asked for. I sent him like a little extra over the top because he was struggling and he needed money. Right. And he thought he was going to get like $500. He thought he was going to get like racks out of this fucking collab, which was, was so petty. Like, come on, man.
Yeah.
But no, I did pay him, and I told you, like, I even asked my girl, and she was like, "Don't fucking pay him, bro." Like, and I'm like, "No, I'm just gonna do it just to avoid any potential drama in the future. Just a nice clean slate. Like, I'll throw in an extra $30 just to call it clean, right?"
Right.
No, don't want it. He wanted more and more. He's very, you know him, and I'm sure he wants things. He wants the world. He wants everything. He wants, you know. So the only thing he wanted a product from his. From his drop, and I basically said, like, just you, if you want to use some of your profit, you know, I'm gonna do it as low as possible. I couldn't bring myself to send it out because it was like a $50 to $60 investment to do so. Just
right.
I feel like maybe if we would have like approached the conversation differently, because he was very aggressive and very like threatening, like cancel culture type style. Like,
oh,
like,
yeah, you know, yeah.
Happens, like. I, you know, all my friends are not going to like it at all, you know, type shit. And I'm like, excuse me, bro. Like, I will never fold to any of that shit, though. Whenever he said something like that, I would always put my foot down and say, look, man, I'm not scared of you at all like that. And then he'd be like, oh, well, come on. I'm a skinny, you know, Brazilian boy. I'm not scared, you know. Ooh.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that was, situations like these. They happen, I guess, for a reason, like, and it, sure enough, it happened to me, but I had to just say something. That's why sometimes I think about that. Well, actually, now I don't really think about it like that anymore, but at the time I was like, some people were like, you really got to call them out like this. I'm like, dude, I'm just trying to like, let people know, like if that, you know, not to work with them, or like, if you're going to work with them, just know, you know, just put it on record type shit, you know?
Yeah, so exactly. Yeah. And you, I think, you know, there's always a positive outlook. I mean, you're always going to learn something from it.
Yeah. The only thing I regret was being like, y'all give $10 to everyone who bought those fucking collab shirts. So, like, just straight up burn them or something. I didn't want to be antagonizing to that extent, you know?
Yeah.
But that's crazy. That was a whirlwind. Can we talk about, like, how that just played out, too? Because afterwards, FBN kind of like wrote on the wave saying like, yo, yeah, actually we were keeping quiet about some of this shit, but now like we're gonna talk about it. So yeah. After that, like, he had the whole, and I don't know, I mean, we know, but after that he had the whole suicide thing go down, and then it turned into like a coma thing, and then right. It turned into like, oh, he's actually logging on to like his Nintendo Switch and going on Discord type
yeah
thing.
The Discord, yeah.
Mom is communicating with the homies type shit. I'm like, god damn. God damn it. Oh my God. What a piece of Facebook history.
And if I may ask, how is the relation with you and FBN?
Dude, you know, it gets stronger by like, I guess the years or whatever. Like, they're really cool people. They make the feed really funny for me. I like them. And
yeah.
You know, I have a collab coming up with Carpenter.
Hell AKA yeah. Carpenter.
A little quick collab we just kind of pieced together. We weren't going to make an official collab, and it just kind of turned out that way. I like stuff like that happens, you know.
Yeah, just like, definitely.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I like them. They cool. They got Weibos.
And yeah, I've had fuck, I think like 90% of them up on here, and they are especially Chino or Drown God. That guy fucking makes me laugh, man.
No, he's funny as hell, dude. They're rambunctious, man.
they really are.
Okay.
What are your plans in the future to keep growing the brand? And hold on, let me rephrase that. What are your plans in the future to keep growing the brand?
Got you. Okay. You know what? Sometimes you have plans and sometimes they fall through. my plan is to, after this big, like, escapade with, like, this, the big income with money through Tyler and the warehouse, honestly, my plans is definitely I want to get plugged with more influencers.
That's kind of like... that's a good idea.
Definitely, you know, influencers. And I want to just be more genuine with each drop and with each thing and just being very smart with, you know, the budgeting. And I definitely, that's my goals with the brand is obviously just to keep throwing, like, fire to the flame and seeing where it goes, you know?
Right, definitely, yeah.
I wish I had, like, a nice, like nice scripted plan. But sometimes those plans don't really work out. That's what I've noticed. It's definitely, it's the opportunities. I just want to open opportunities. I want to put it like that. I think that would be a very good way of putting it. I want to be humble to these new opportunities and just keep my heart open, keep my mind sharp, you know, learn from mistakes. That's more so like it used to be like last year. I was like, you know, I want to find an investor. I want to find, you know, space. Obviously, those things are still in the picture, but I realized it's like those, like, kind of like, how would I say, the stuff that goes on within, it really paints the bigger picture. So right. I just want to be in a headspace. I don't want to be consumed by stress. You know, I want to make time for my family too. I'm not, like, my, you know, my mom, my dad, and stuff like that.
Definitely.
My brother. So those things, this year in particular, especially after COVID last year, it was like, it was a fucking roller coaster, and it was like,
yeah.
It made me just kind of, it made me, as weird as it sounds, I just kind of made me want to pull back and just, like, realign and just being like, yo, you know, I want to be good. And that's going to make, I'm going to make sure that that happens and that gets fulfilled.
Yeah. You know, really put everything into perspective.
Exactly. So that's, I want to make sure that's, like, my number one, you know, key piece within my family ties, key piece within myself and my friends. You know, I love my friends. I want them to be safe too. And then maybe 2022, you know, the year is still early. I'm sure by September, I'm going to have a little plan forming on how we can, you know, get on World Star or
get on pages,
you know, stuff like that. I want to collab with bigger people. You know, I want to collab with people that, you know, have been waiting a while to collab, you know,
right,
stuff
like right. that.